Very good morning. I welcome you all again in this video lecture series of energy engineering. Myself Professor Harish Fadtare, and I am working as assistant professor in mechanical engineering department of SVPM's College of Engineering, Malegaon. Today's topic that we will learn is a power plant instrumentation. When I am considering power plant instrumentation, it is also a very important topic when we are learning about power plant engineering or energy engineering. As in this chapter, we shall discuss the basic principle of electrical equipments, basic principle of different electrical equipments which we are using generally in power plant at different sections. Different sections means it may be transmission section, it may be distribution section, or it may be generation section. And how we can categorize this study is also very important. So the content of this whole study we are dividing in different parts, that is a different layout of electrical equipments, then study about generator and its cooling, exciter, short circuits and its limiting method, switch gear, circuit breakers, power transformer, methods of earthings, protective devices and control system in power plant, measurement of high voltage, current and power and control room. So when I am just reading this list of content, we can say that in power plant instrumentation we have a different devices which we have to learn. Different devices, those are related with the safety, controlling, measuring and efficient operation of the power plant as such. So we will see now each and everything in brief. But before going into it, we will see how is the layout of electrical equipment in power plant. So I have just put, there are 12 different I have just categorized it in two parts, primary power line side and secondary power line side. In the first part I have a primary power lines, second is a ground wire, overhead lines, transformer for the measurement of electrical voltage, disconnected switch, circuit breaker, current transformer and lighting arrester. So these are the different electrical equipments in the primary power line side. And when I am considering the secondary power line side, I have a current transformer, lighting arrester, main transformer, control building, security fencing and secondary power lines. So this is the generalized layout of electrical equipments in power plant. So these electrical equipment, we have to see the basic principle of all these electrical equipments we have to learn. So this is the secondary power line side and this one is the primary power line side. So primary power line side comes as on this side and left hand side. On the right hand side we are finding secondary power line side. So again, just we are enlisting these different major electrical equipments as a generator, exciter, synchronizing equipment, CB circuit breaker, current and potential transformer, relays and protective equipments, isolators, lighting arrester, earthing equipment, station transformer and battery and motor for driving auxiliary. So these are the electrical equipments. In previous slide what we have seen, how is the layout of electrical equipment, how is the actual location of all these different elements. But here we are just enlisting different elements or different equipments. So with this we will start with very important equipment, that is generator. Now all in modern power plant when we are considering, that is alternating current generators, alternating current generators, that is called as alternator or synchronous generator, alternator or synchronous generator. These alternators are coupled with power producing shaft or turbine, power producing shaft or turbine, either directly as in case of diesel engine, when we can say, or with the help of you may say gears to convert mechanical energy into electrical energy. So mechanical to electrical conversion we can obtain with the help of this. The principle of electromagnetic induction is used for generation of electrical power with the help of generator, and this an alternator or you may say generator consists of fixed stator and revolving rotor. Fixed stator and revolving rotor. So these rotary generators built today use the basic principle of a generator action. Generator action. The relationship between magnetism and electrical current was discovered and documented by Oersted in 1819. He found that if an electrical current was caused to flow through the conductor, that the magnetic field was produced around the conductor. Then Faraday discovered that if a conductor is moved through a magnetic field, an electrical voltage is induced in the conductor. This is the basic principles on which this generator works. The magnitude of this generated voltage is directly proportional to the strength of magnetic field, and the rate at which conductor crosses the magnetic field, the induced voltage has a polarity that will oppose the change causing the induction, that is Lenz law. So Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, Lenz law, is the basis of or the working principle for this generator. Natural phenomena is known as a generator action and is described today by the Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, that is V induction is equal to delta O divided by delta T, where V induction is equal to induced voltage is equal to change in flux density to the change in time. So all rotary generator built today use the basic principle of generator action. The main difference between them is in regard to what spin and what is fixed. In an alternator, electricity is produced when a magnetic field spins inside the stator, that is winding of wire. In generator, on the other hand, the armature or winding of wire spins inside a fixed magnet, inside a fixed magnet field to generate electricity. So this is the very important, the main difference between what spin and what is fixed. When I am considering an alternator, electricity is produced when magnetic field spins inside stator. Inside stator, magnetic field spins, winding of wire. In a generator, on the other hand, the armature or winding of wire spin inside a fixed magnetic field. Magnetic field is fixed to generate electricity. So generator is a machine coupled with turbine which converts mechanical energy to electrical energy by collecting outsourcing fuel like fossil fuels, wind, solar or steam, etc. The turbine supplies mechanical energy to the generator which converts it into electrical energy. Now the energy conversion is based on the theories of Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. Again, it is very important. It cannot develop energy by its own source. It needs some outsource fuel. It is used in all major power plants, as you may say, thermal, solar, or hydroelectric power plant as such. So now, how actually we are utilizing the concept, that is the Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction or Lenz law. So the voltage induced in the stationary inductor when the magnetic field moves across it, reversing the direction of movement of the magnetic field, will cause the direction of induced voltage and resulting current flow to reverse. So this is the emitter, this is the direction of motion, this is the fixed conductor. The conductor is fixed, and this is the direction of motion of this. So again, the same thing they have shown here. This is the, now in the second case you can see this is the stator field, this is the rotor field, and this is the slip rings, and this is the connection which gives the output, AC output we can judge from here. So these are the two cases in which we are interested for alternator as generator. So types of turbine generator, essentially there are two basic types of generator. One is the DC generator, AC generator, we are calling it as alternator, asynchronous induction generator and synchronous generator. And based on the turbine generators, that use of the turbine generator, basic first in, we have seen is the basic types of generators, and now according to its application we can say wind turbine generator, steam turbine generator, hydro turbine generator and solar turbine generator as such. So there are different parts. With the help of these two pictures we can say the generator frame, inner end shield, turbine generator fan, rotating field, then collector ring, main coupling, generator coolers, stator core, air gap, stator coil entrance and terminal lead. So these are the different parts of a generators. Now when I'm considering the operation of the generator, very important phenomena comes into picture, and that is a generator cooling. Depending upon the rating and design and the operation of the generator stator core and winding may be cooled by air, oil or hydrogen or water, that is the cooling medium we can use. For direct cool generator, the coolant is in direct contact with the heat produced members, and in the case of indirect cool generator, the coolant cools generator by relying on heat transfer through the insulation only, The generator, a failure of cooling system can result in a rapid deterioration of stator core and lamination insulation and stator winding conductors and insulation. So this is very important aspect when I am considering generators cooling. So failure may occur. So air cooled generators, the basic configurations of air cooled generators, open ventilated, that is we can say OV design. Air is drawn from outside the unit through the filter, passes through the generator and is discharged outside the generator. And the second is a totally enclosed water to air cooled, that is totally enclosed, TEWAC. In the TEWAC design, air is circulated within the generator passing through the frame. As you can say, these two air cooled generator basic configuration that we have discussed. Then the second very important backbone of the generator control system is the exciter. So exciter is the backbone of the generator control system. It is the power source that supplies the DC magnetizing current to the field winding of a synchronous generator, thereby ultimately inducing AC voltage and current in the generator armature. Two basic kinds of exciters. The first one is the rotating, second one is the static exciters. So rotating exciters we can call as per their configuration brush and brushless, and static exciter we can call them as series and shunt. So the amount of excitation required to maintain the output voltage constant is the function of generator load, and as the generator load increases, when there is a generator increment in the load increases, the amount of excitation also goes on increasing. Generator load increases, amount of excitation goes on increasing. So two basic kinds of exciters, and as we have seen, this is the backbone, and it is power, as it is a power source that is supplying DC magnetizing current to the field winding of a synchronous generator. So this is very important thing. When I am considering rotating exciters as per their configurations, you can say this brushless without pilot exciters, and second one is the brushless with pilot exciters. So according to this configuration, rotating exciters may be brushless, may be brush type, static exciters, may be shunt type and series type. When I am considering series type, operating field power from generator output voltage and current. Operating field power from generator output voltage. From generator output voltage. So static excitation means no moving part. Static. There is no any moving part. It provides faster transient response than rotary exciters. So this is the comparison between rotating exciters and static exciters. See, when I am considering static exciters, static excitation means no moving parts, and that's why it provides faster transient response than rotary exciters as such. So I have shown this is the conventional type of exciters, conventional types of exciters. This is the static type of exciters. This is the brushless exciters as such. So apart from this, very important thing, short circuit and limiting methods. So what are the different when I am considering short circuit methods? Short circuit is an abnormal connection between two nodes of an electrical circuit intended to be at a different voltage. This result is an electric current limited only by the equivalent resistance of a rest of the network, which can cause electric circuit damage, overheating and fire or explosion. So short circuit is an abnormal connection between two nodes of an electric circuit intended to be at a different voltages. So protective devices are designed to detect a fault condition and shut off the electric current before there is a significant damage. There are number of different types of protective devices. Various short circuit calculation methods are Thevenin impedance short circuit currents calculation method, symmetrical component SCC calculation method, time constant methods. So these are the different methods for calculation, and current limiting method is the practice in electrical or electronic circuit of imposing an upper limit on the current that may be delivered to the load. See, current limiting is the practice. It is very important practice in electrical or electronic circuitry of imposing an upper limit of the current that may be delivered to the load with an purpose of protecting the circuit, generating or transmitting the current from harmful effect due to short circuit or similar problem in the load. So there is inrush current limiting, single power supply circuit, slew rate control. So these are the different current limiting methods. So when I am considering a power plant instrumentation, these are the very important thing to have short circuit and its limiting methods, that is the current limiting methods. Then very important next thing is the switch gear. Now when I am considering the switch gear, when switch gear comes into picture, is essentially consist of switching and protecting device called the switch gear system is consisting different devices which are switching and protecting devices, which is having switches, fuses, isolators, CB means control, that is circuit breakers, protective relays, lightning arresters, current transformer, potential transformer, auto enclosures and various associated equipment with it. It is used to control protectives and protect electrical equipment and to isolate it. So switch gears has two types of component: power conducting components. These conduct or interrupt the power flow, such as switches, circuit breaker, fuses, isolator, relays, lightning arrestor, and so on. These interrupt these devices, power conducting devices. These conduct or interrupt the power flow. Then control systems, these monitors control or protect the power conducting components, such as control panels. Means there are two kinds of devices. So potential transformer, associated circuitry, and so on. So switch gear is directly linked to the supply system and based on the voltage level, and can be classified as either low voltage, medium voltage, and high voltage switch gear as such. Now when I am considering the switch gear is a general term which constitutes all parts of equipments, which consist of all parts of equipments of a power system whose function is to receive and distribute electrical power. So this is very important thing, and finally we can understand with this discussion, that is, what is the function of a switch gear. The faults are localized and the faulty plants are automatically disconnected from the system by the operation of protective equipment to break short circuit without giving rise to dangerous condition, and to facilitate redistribution of loads, inspection and maintenance on this system. So switch gear must be designed in a such a manner that it is reliable under all operating condition, and system is easily accessible from alternator to the outgoing feeder. So this is very important thing regarding switch gear. So this is 420 kilovolt gas insulated switch gear, some images, industrial switch gear. Then circuit breakers, this uses SF and air as an insulations, and this is the tram switch gear as such. Then next is the circuit breaker. As a name of this device is circuit breaker. To break the circuit, we are using the circuit breaker. Circuit breaker is a switching device that interrupts, that disconnects the abnormal or fault current. It is a mechanical device and that disturbs the flow of high magnitude fault current, and in addition performs the function of a switch. The circuit breaker is mainly designed for closing or opening of the electrical circuit and thus protect the electrical system from damage. The circuit breaker essentially consists of fixed and moving contacts. These contacts are touching each other and carrying the current under normal condition when the circuit is closed. When the circuit breaker is closed, the current carrying contact called electrode engaged each other under the pressure of the spring. During the normal operating condition, the arms of the circuit breaker can be opened or closed for switching and maintenance of the system. To open the circuit breaker, only the pressure is required to be applied to a trigger. Whenever fault occurs on any part of the system, the trip coil of the breaker gets energized and moving contacts are getting apart from each other by some mechanism, thus opening the circuit. So this is mechanical device, and this is the switching device that interrupts abnormal or fault current. This is the function of the circuit breaker. How I can categorize the circuit breaker? Circuit breakers are mainly classified on the basis of rated voltage. So circuit breakers below rated voltage of 1000 volt are known as low voltage circuit breakers, and above 1000 volts are called as the high voltage circuit breakers. So circuit breaker is above 1000 volt and below 1000 volt. So the most general way of classification of the circuit breaker is on the basis of medium of arc extinction. Such types of circuit breakers are as follows: oil circuit breaker, bulk oil circuit breaker, minimum oil circuit breaker, minimum circuit breakers, air blast circuit breaker, sulfur hexafluoride circuit breakers, vacuum CB, airs break CB. Now, when I am considering all high voltage circuit breaker may be classified under two main categories, that is oil, as we discussed, oil circuit breakers and air circuit breakers as such. Two pole miniature circuit breaker, so different images I have tried to show you, you can see. Power transformer, so again when I am considering the transformer, so what is the transformer? Transformer is the transformation which is doing transformation or converts the alternating current, converts the alternating current electrical energy of one voltage to the alternating current of desired voltage. So this is the function of the transformer. The transformer is the static machine used for transforming power from one circuit to another circuit without changing frequency. This is a very basic definition of transformer. Transformer operates on an AC supply and works in the principle of mutual induction. So this is very important. Transformer can be categorized in different ways depending upon their purpose, use and construction. Step up and step down transformer, three phase transformer and single phase transformer, electrical power distribution and instrument transformer, two winding transformer and auto transformer, outdoor transformer and indoor transformer, oil cooled and dry type transformer, core type and shell type, berry type of transformer. So these are the different transformers which we can enlist here. So these are the few images in which in power plant at Paramati Solar Power Station we have seen this kind of transformer. This is the power make electrical 100 kilo kVA transformer, and this is the step down transformer. Applied alternating current supply, just this is the primary winding, this is iron core and this is the secondary winding having less turns than the primary winding, you may say. So this is the regarding you may say very important parts, that is transformer. Now very important thing regarding transformer that we are omitting here, just I want to include it now, it is that how to do the transformer cooling. The transformer gets heated up due to iron and copper loss in them. So there is iron loss, there is copper loss in the transformer, and that's why you may say power transformer gets heated, and it is necessary to cool those transformer up to a limiting temperature so that insulation of the windings and core is not get deteriorated. So there are transformers are two types, basically dry and oil immersed types. So dry type of transformer when I am considering, dry type of transformer when I am considering as far as cooling of transformer is concerned, small transformer of capacity 25 kVA, we can use dry kind of cooling system. The cooling used in such a type of dry transformer is either a natural air circulation method in which surrounding air is circulated to carry away the heat generated. Alternatively, when I am considering the transformer, use the forced air circulation method in which air is forced through the core and windings through the filter. But when transformer is of a capacity more than 25 kVA or a bigger capacity transformer, special type of mineral oils are required there for transformation cooling. So in high capacity transformer, cooling is effected both by forced air and cooling type of transformer, you may say, as such. Now this we are we can see very important thing, that is earthing and its method. Earthing is used to protect you from electrical shock. It does this by providing a path to a protective conductor for a fault current to flow to earth. It also causes the protective devices, either circuit breaker or fuse, to do this. So there are several methods of earthing: wire, strip earthing, rod earthing, pipe earthing, plate earthing, earthing through the water mains. So there are the different methods of earthing: earthing through the electrode, pipe earth electrodes, plate earth electrode, earthing through the water mains. So these are the different earthing methods. So very important thing is the protective devices and control system. So power system protection, as the branch of electrical power engineering that deals with the protection of electrical power system from faults, through the disconnection of faulted parts from the rest of the electrical network. The objective of the protection scheme is to keep the power system stable. Stability is very important, by isolating only the component that are under fault, whilst leaving as much of the network as possible still in operation. Thus, protection scheme must apply a very pragmatic and pessimistic approach to clearing system faults. The devices that are used to protect the power system from faults are called as the protection devices. Generator, transformer should get protected, or bus bar or transmission line should get protected from the devices. So this is the protective system and its control. That is the, don't get bother with this, just consider the layout. When I'm considering the layout, this is the generator protection, this is the transformer protection, this is the line protection. So these are the different protection, and this is the bus protection. So this is the bus bar and its protection, this is the transformer and its protection. So what I'm trying to tell you is that there are fuses, low resistance sacrificial fuses, relays, sense fault and trip CB, contact circuit breakers, then transformer, earthing and grounding. So these are the different methods with which we can move further. Protective devices and control system comes with the different components, types of protections and their coordination, disturbance and monitoring equipment and performance measures. So measurement is also very important as a, when I'm considering power plant instrumentation, because there are different parameters required to be calculated: high voltage, current and power. Current transfer is used to measure current from high voltage line. It step down rated system to 1 to 5 ampere and measured using meter. Potential transformer is used to measure voltage above 380 volt. PT makes conversion of high voltage with primary and convert to measurable range in secondary. Power is calculated as V into I. So batteries are used to store the power. So this is a 33 kilovolt current transformer picture just I have shown there. And very important is the control room. Control room is a nerve center of power station. So as we have our brain, so control room is also there. Various methods like voltage adjustment, load control, emergency tripping of turbine, different things. So we can control from the control room as our brain. Brain is our control room. Location of control room is always and should near to the switch house. It is very essential thing. So this is very essential thing, that is location of control room and location of switch house should be very much closer to each other. There should not be no glare, neat and clean and well ventilated and free from draughts. Well trained manpower is needed to operate the control room. So this is very important thing. So this is the control room. In lot of power plants you can see, from small power plant to a bigger power plant, you can see the control room where different controllers are there. Whole power plant we are controlling with the help of trained manpower. With the help of trained manpower we are controlling the power plant. Now there are different softwares with which we are finding interfaces of these different electrical and mechanical equipments, and we are operating, controlling, measuring different parameters as such with the help of control room. So I hope you are enjoying my lecture, and definitely you have certain confusion in your mind about your final examination, but as far as my experience is saying, that there will be examination of a 70 mark paper for at least duration. You will find for solving that paper is for 2 hours, and there will be exam as far as my experience is saying. So keep in touch with all my lectures. Enjoy this lecture series of energy engineering, and take care of yourself and your family members also. Thank you for watching this video. Thank you very much.